Greetings and welcome back to NYSORA YouTube channel. Dr. Hadzic here. In this video, I will talk about what I believe should never be done during interscalene brachial plexus block. The technique that I will describe is often seen on YouTube, Facebook, and other social media where enthusiastic practitioners flaunt or share their skills in video which they post. While these videos often demonstrate an extreme degree of skill, they should not be reproduced without giving it safety considerations. Before we get started, please take a quick second to subscribe to the NYSORA YouTube channel so you don't miss the future videos. Historically, interscalene brachial plexus block was developed by Dr. Alan Winnie as a method to accomplish anesthesia of the entire upper extremity with the one single injection. Back in the 70s and 80s, ultrasound technology was not developed enough to provide the required resolution and the guidance for peripheral nerve blocks. The clinicians in that era had to rely on paresthesia sensation. In short, the needle was advanced through the skin and interscalene muscles by palpating the anatomy and utilizing clinical skills and feel instead of objectively monitoring the anatomy and needle relationship, as is the case in modern regional anesthesia. But what is important to realize that even without ultrasound guidance, one single injection of local anesthetic using paresthesia or nerve stimulation resulted in a successful interscalene brachial plexus block in more than 95% of patients. Fast forward a couple of decades, and today we have the technology that allows us to monitor the needle path and to assure that that one injection occurs in a therapeutic space, namely the interscalene brachial plexus sheath. While in the past, without ultrasound, we never knew where that injection went, today with ultrasound guidance, we are certain where injection occurs, which allows us to limit the number of interventions to one single injection and to decrease the amount of local anesthetic because we can see its distribution. We simply stop injecting local anesthetic into the brachial plexus sheath when the distribution is adequate. But let's review that in the NYSORA's reverse ultrasound anatomy illustration. So here's the fabled NYSORA's reverse ultrasound anatomy. The middle scalene muscle, which is here, that is the fascia that envelops the brachial plexus. It is called cervical fascia. And that is the brachial plexus, which is enveloped in the brachial plexus sheath. The brachial plexus sheath is basically made up of connective tissue that shares its fibers with the middle scalene and anterior scalene muscles. And inside the sheath is the elements of the brachial plexus. So with the brachial plexus technique, in interscalene brachial plexus, all we really want to do is pass the needle inside the brachial plexus sheath and inject local anesthetic one time. Once we see that the brachial plexus elements are pushed away from the needle, that is a sure sign that the injection is correct. So basically, as opposed to paresthesia techniques where we never really knew after the paresthesia or a needle nerve contact occurred where the local anesthetic went, with the ultrasound, we always do. Likewise, even with the nerve stimulation techniques in the past, once you get a motor response, we knew that the needle was in a correct position, most likely, but we never knew where the local anesthetic went. Today, we have the luxury of knowing exactly where the local anesthetic goes, and therefore we do not need to make multiple injections. And let's see now how multiple injections can be hazardous. So here's the video that I spotted on social media. This is an interscalene brachial plexus. It is very nicely outlined anatomy, and it's a very skilled practitioner who identifies the elements of the brachial plexus very correctly. So here's the needle that goes in, and the needle first attempts to inject the local anesthetic at the level of C5. We can see how the needle breaches the stroma of the brachial plexus, which is what the publication we talked about advises against. And the needle goes now over on the other side of the brachial plexus. As just when you think that that injection would be adequate, the needle is now being recorrected and advanced towards a C5 again. So here we can see between C5 and C6, the needle pierces the stroma again, which is unnecessary according to the Spencer colleagues, the publication that we just saw. Here's another injection. I'm counting injection number two. The practitioner here is even pushing the C5 and the C6 with the needle while attempting to make another injection, which occurs right there. So again, we now have injection number three and injection number four on the opposite side of the interscalene brachial plexus. Just when you think that there will be enough, there's injection number seven. And then the needle injects a local anesthetic going back. So you would think that is now adequate, but not exactly. Here's injection number eight. So here we have witnessed eight injections into the interscalene brachial plexus for what could have been accomplished by the one single injection. Unfortunately, as you could see, ultrasound is sometimes used as a video game. Because ultrasound can monitor the needle-nerve relationship, some clinicians perform multiple injections of local anesthetic at different places within the brachial plexus sheath in order to improve the success rate, enhance the onset time, and decrease the total amount of local anesthetic. However, the research clearly shows that single injection of local anesthetic outside of the stroma of the brachial plexus is adequate. Likewise, brachial plexus block can be successfully obtained with as little as 5 to 7 milliliter local anesthetic. This gives us an opportunity to decrease the risk of both nerve injury and the risk of systemic local anesthetic toxicity. Think about it. Every insertion of the needle into human tissue carries a risk of injury in a nerve, even under ultrasound guidance. Likewise, every injection of local anesthetic carries a risk of injecting it into a vulnerable structure, such as the root of the brachial plexus in interscalene space. If we utilize a logic, the more needle insertions we do, the higher the risk of nerve injury, as the risk from a single injection simply gets multiplied by the number of needle insertions. Similarly, if a single injection of local anesthetic carries a certain risk of nerve injury due to an injection into the space where we don't want to inject it, that risk increases with every additional injection. Unfortunately, the enthusiasm for ultrasound-guided interventions sometimes may lead to unnecessary injections just because the expertise of the operator can be such that multiple injections can be carried out with a greater degree of control and therefore relatively safely. However, promoting multiple injections of local anesthetics to accomplish a nerve block where a single injection is adequate is not a prudent practice, even in expert hands, and it may lead to a higher risk of complications when the trainees attempt to reproduce multiple injection techniques. In summary, I personally advise against performing multiple needle insertions and injections in interscalene brachial plexus block. It is not necessary. In our practice, where we perform over 6,000 blocks annually, interscalene brachial plexus block is always performed with a single injection with a success rate that nears 100%. I hope you find the information in this video useful, and if so, please subscribe to help us grow the channel. Now, feel free to post comments or ask questions in the comment section, and we would love to hear what you do in your practice to accomplish successful interscalene brachial plexus blocks, and whether you feel that multiple injections are warranted or necessary. Thank you for watching. Until next time.